Jas, Jason, thanks so much for joining us today from balmy Arizona. How are you guys doing today?
Doing good, Mark. Thanks. Real good. Thanks for having us.
We're struggling up here in the minus 10 and snow and everything else, and you guys are seemingly living the dream down there at ALTIS Performance in Arizona. So tell us a little bit about how you both got there and the kind of work that you're doing.
All right. Well, this is Jason here. I'm from Michigan originally, so I finished my undergrad up there about 3 years ago in exercise science, and was looking for opportunities beyond that. So it was recommended to me to look into an internship here, which at the time we were still called World Athletic Center. So I came down for 7 weeks in the spring of 2014 as an intern. Fell in love with everything, the coaches, the athletes, the philosophies, and was fortunate enough for the timing to work out for them to offer me a position to come back for the next season. So that's really how I ended up at ALTIS. I'm the strength and power coach, so my main role is in the weight room. I also spend the mornings on the track with our pro and emerging elite sprint groups.
Awesome. And you guys have a pretty integrative approach there, right, Jas? Like, can you tell us your end and how you guys intermix together?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think one of the defining features of what we do at ALTIS, which is a little bit different from other organizations, is subscribing to this idea of the performance trinity, which is what performance therapy is really all about. That trinity incorporates three different entities. One would be the athlete, and it's of course an athlete-centered model. The other two would be the sport coach himself or herself, and the therapist. And together, these three individuals will work almost in unison, if you will, to help create an opportunity for the athlete to express her full potential of what we need to do. What this looks like on a day-to-day basis then is therapists working in unison with our coaches, albeit sport coach or, like Jason, a strength and power coach. And we're fully integrated into the system. So when Jason's at the track, the therapists are at the track. And of course, your athletes are there as well. So what we aim to do is really have this model set up so that we're able to affect change immediately, versus a clinical model where you might have an athlete who goes to a practice, then they come see you, and there's a time gap between there. The communication between, say, a clinician or their therapist and the coach is a little bit slow. The athlete will leave you. Might be 24 hours later before he's at practice again and seeing any change from your inputs. And so what we try to do is really eliminate that and look to minimize any type of training gap in what we prescribe to athletes.
Wow, that's fantastic. I mean, I know we still see today in elite sport, people and medical teams working sort of in silos, like you mentioned, kind of one therapist and getting treated and then off to the coach or whatnot. So for you guys, what does a day look like then for, an athlete that's coming in to sprint? I mean, how does it, what does it look like in terms of, when Jason sees him or yourself or this integrated model?
Yeah. So, right now, let's say that an athlete start time is at 10 o'clock in the morning. At 9:30, they'll show up at the track and we'll go through a therapy pre-check. This pre-check is just a chance for the therapist to really just get their hands on the athletes. I deal with any issues from, say, the previous day or any key areas that we want to investigate prior to their warm-up. Once that 10 o'clock rolls around, they get into their warm-up, which will be led by Jason along with the coaches. At that point, the therapists are watching warm-up and really using notational analysis to kind of assess how an athlete's moving, what their pattern's looking like, and where they are compared to their normal bandwidth. We'll then go through our training session, and that could be, either extensive or it could be a short, depending on where we are in the training cycle. Once they're done with their training session, we'll head back to the weight room, and they'll go through their lift, whatever was prescribed. And again, Jason's the one who's leading that. On the floor with them will be, again, the therapist and the coaches. Therapists are expected to help in the weight room as well. And then once that they're done their lift. If there is any additional therapy work that needs to be provided kind of in more of a clinical setting where we can spend maybe a little bit more time with the athletes, we'll have them do that, or we'll have them go through any type of regeneration schemes that we have planned for them.
Awesome, awesome. And now, Jason, on your side as the strength coach there, when you're looking at the warm-ups and seeing, and communicating with Jas, I mean, obviously you've got your plan on what you guys, what you want the guys to do for their lifts and whatnot, but can you speak to a bit of what you might pick up on certain days and how you might call some audibles and change things up a little bit with your athletes?
Yeah, absolutely. And it all starts, the moment they walk into to the practice facility. We're constantly watching just to see how they're moving, what their energy levels are like. I'm constantly paying attention to who's on the table and even in particular what Jas might be working on. And then for really starting with a warm-up, we do essentially the same warm-up almost every day. Sometimes we'll go back and forth between two slightly different warm-ups. But this allows us, as Jas kind of alluded to determine athlete norms and how they typically move. And then when they're getting away from those norms and too far on one end of the spectrum, it starts to really stand out for both the coaches and the therapists, whether it be a technical issue or a mechanical issue or fatigue levels. We're able to start picking up on these things and then make any adjustments that we may need to make. And then in the weight room, I think it helps tremendously that I'm at the track and the folks from the track are also in the weight room. So there's a ton of collaboration and it's truly integrated. And that way I know if they have a really big session on the track and a couple of particular athletes hit that session really hard and have a great day, there might be a little bit of residual fatigue once we get in the weight room. So maybe we'll adjust a little volume or switch some things around to accommodate for that.
And are there certain things, can you walk us through a couple of the things in terms of your warm-up, like for elite sprinters, are there some of the techniques that you guys use for the warm-up?
Yeah, it's a pretty lengthy warm-up, anywhere from 35 to 55 minutes. We utilize kind of the same structure each day, and then we'll manipulate slightly within that. So we start with torso activation, just getting things fired up, fairly general in that regard. And then work our way into some more specificity. We go in through dynamic mobility, where we're just big, open, bouncy movements, getting them warm. On acceleration days, we'll add in some accelerations at a very low intensity in between each of those drills. And that's anywhere from 6 to 12 drills there. Dynamic flexibility comes next, so it's a series of different leg swings, making sure we got full range of motion through hips and shoulders and everything's moving smoothly. And then we get more specific into sprint drills. So a lot of AWOC variations, high knee variations, whatever you want to call it, through different cadences and different environmental challenges. Again, if it's an acceleration themed workout, we'll add some accelerations in between each of those drills just to allow for some additional repetition for those athletes and hopefully some additional transfer from the drills to the sporting movement.
And in terms of sprinting, I mean, growing up when I was watching sprinting, we had, the Ben Johnsons, the Donovan Baileys of the world that were sort of a classic, what you would think of as a classic sprinter build. And of course, in the last decade with, Usain Bolt and, longer levers, taller. And now, obviously, you guys have the, amazing young Canadian there, Andre Degrasse down there, who's also a different, sort of a more slight kind of whippet type build. So can you speak to a little bit of the different body types and maybe does that change at all in terms of what you're doing in the weight room? How does that impact the sprinting?
Yeah. So I'll speak to that maybe from a therapy standpoint. Really what we see is maybe two ends of the spectrum where I like to classify an athlete as being very mechanically driven. So these are the guys that are quite muscular and will use those abilities to their benefit. And then on the other end of the spectrum, we have guys who are a little bit more fascially driven, and this is like Andre. So they're not big and bulky, but they have this elastic component to them that allows them to harness that energy and kind of transmit force on the track, perhaps a little bit differently than someone who's mechanic. Now, of course, there's going to be hybrids of each, and this example is really just to drive home the point. In addition to that, anthropometrics have definitely changed. We have some athletes who are, quite large, like taller, longer levers, and their ability to transmit force is slightly different than, say, someone who's a little bit shorter. So yeah, there definitely is a spectrum of athletes, and the way we need to assess them perhaps becomes a little bit different depending on that.
Gotcha. Yeah, that's, I mean, definitely, obviously in basketball, we see that sort of tension being a big part of, you know, lean guys being able to get up and being quick. So that's really interesting about, you know, with Andre as well. Now, as we, you know, we've heard a lot from other coaches in terms of this idea of power being essential to learning the right sprinting technique and being almost more important than even the technique. Can you guys speak to that a little bit and in your athletes?
Yeah, it's an interesting topic. And it reminds me of a recent post that came out on Stu McMillan's blog with his strength series. And an additional part there from Jeremy Witherspoon, who's a speed skater, was a speed skater, now he's a coach in Norway. Arguably one of the greatest speed skaters of all time, but he hypothesizes that his technique was so sound because he learned it without having any strength levels, essentially, with no background in training. He wasn't able to just power through poor technique in order to be fast. It really required that he had proper technique and he was applying force in the proper directions in order for him to be fast. And I thought that was a really interesting concept. And then just to bring it around, it's technique really trumps all, especially for us with the population that we're with. These guys are already quite powerful and strong. The difference that's going to be made in their performance is going to come from changes in technique. So we have intense sessions with a lot of coaching, and we're just trying to hone in on all these differences that we can make through the technical model.
That's interesting. I mean, I've heard, similarly experts like, you know, Derek Hansen mentioned that when he was sprinting at school, he'd put all this time in the gym, you know, Olympic lifts, really building up the amount of mass he could move, and then, you know, the change in his total sprint time, I forget what he mentioned, but it dropped, you know, not nearly as much as he'd hoped with all that sort of gym work. Now, obviously, gym work's important, but can you talk about the balance there between, you know, developing power and speed without inherently having to move weights or using the track to do that?
I'd say it comes from both, really. But I think a common misconception is that you need to use weights, heavy weights above 85%, in order to get strong and powerful. But in reality, dynamic effort lifts in the weight room will bring about those strength levels. And there may not be a lot of published research to show it, but there's a lot of anecdotal evidence from a lot of successful coaches who have implemented programs really with very little emphasis on maximum strength. So I think it's a spectrum really when it comes down to it. And with developing athletes, you might have an opportunity to find more performance gains by going from a strength approach. And then as they progress into more elite, taking more of a technical approach. But that being said, with the developing athletes, I think too many coaches ruin their long-term development by chasing these quick numbers, whether that be through the weight room or on the track or the field or whatever it might be. So I think it's a fine line and it's a difficult balance. But for us, it all comes back to the track. Okay. So everything we do in the weight room is just to supplement the work that we're putting in on the track.
I would say from a developing athlete standpoint, it's crucial to do a needs analysis to find out what specifically you think that athlete needs to address. There's tons of research now that, you know, supports the idea that maximum strength work is going to have a translation onto, you know, velocity and being able to sprint. But what we need to be careful of is, you know, the populations that they're actually using in these studies, in addition to the long-term effects. So what are the longitudinal studies that show if you continue to work in the max end spectrum, what happens to, say, fibers? Now, to my knowledge, there is no paper that shows that you start to get more oxidative qualities, which inherently to me mean the rate of force development is a little bit slower. However, the peak that you're going to have from a force development standpoint is obviously going to increase. But where does that lie in your spectrum of what you're trying to look for in your athletes. So understanding that a needs analysis is going to be a key, I think, is a big takeaway for coaches who are working with the developing athlete.
Yeah, that's some great advice, because I know a lot of especially young strength coaches, you know, chasing that board, that PR or max lift board is something that they often use as a way to assess the progress of a young athlete. And it sounds like from what you guys are saying that there's a place for that, and it's important. But the more elite someone gets, then the more specific with their needs, and of course even technique, etc., becomes trumps all, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Now, in terms of your elite sprinters, if we shift over to other areas of sort of performance leaks, if we look at this integrative approach of whether it's things that you do on the recovery side, things that we do on the nutritional side, or in terms of sleep, etc., can you speak to any of the techniques or things that you guys implement with your guys?
Yeah, from a recovery standpoint, we like to keep it quite basic, to be honest. There's lots of things that we can do, but often just chasing low-hanging fruit is something that goes overlooked, perhaps, and I think sleep is one of those. We would like to prescribe that each athlete has, at minimum 70 hours of sleep a week, which doesn't seem like a task that should be difficult, but again, once you start working with, this age group, even getting that can be sometimes a little bit of a challenge. In addition to that, we do like to educate our athletes on proper nutritional choices. We're fortunate that we have a series called ALTIS U, in which one of our coaching staff, and it kind of rotates through, we'll do a presentation for the athletes, and it will kind of encompass various topics, one of which would be nutrition, one of which would be recovery, and what they're doing. And what we're trying to accomplish with that is making our athletes have actionable intelligence. And so they're not just going to go through this process and not have any say or not really understand what they're doing and why they're doing it. I think increasing the athlete's IQ as to what's involved in being a professional athlete is one of the more crucial things we can do. Anything you would want to add to that, Jason?
I think it's sometimes it's challenging with some. We see a lot of guys who are very on top of their lifestyle, and they're eating all the right things at the right times, and they're keeping sleep journals. And then we see elite athletes who eat burgers and fries and stay up till 2 a.m. playing video games, but are still good at their craft, still extremely good at their craft. So it's an interesting topic, but our approach is just, as Jas said, educate the athlete as much as we can, equip them with everything that they need in order to be successful, and then hope that in the 18, 19 hours of the day that we're not with them, that they're doing the right things.
That's great. I mean, it sounds like you guys are helping your athletes build habits, which is, as you guys know, is especially on the nutrition front, is just a major, major fundamental of building those habits so deeply ingrained in them that they just get up and that's what they eat and that's what they do. And like you mentioned, Jas, that sets you up for that, being a professional into the long term. And I love what you mentioned there around, we call them the basics, but these sort of fundamentals are so crucial. And some of them are, those easy wins, like you mentioned, of just getting things like the right amount of sleep in, that are so fundamental, especially for young, adolescent, young adult athletes is really key. Now, I know with a lot of our guys, the phone is definitely an issue, or trying to minimize a lot of that late night screen time, Instagram, Twitter, all the rest of it. Any strategies that you guys have or little tips for other strength coaches and young trainers out there to help with their athletes?
Yeah, to be honest, when the athletes are on the table, a little bit of a dictatorship, phones away. They need to be a part of the process, not just this bystander. We don't think therapy should be passive.
Love it. That's great.
Yeah, our athletes are unique in the sense that they're very in tune to their bodies, and their ability to report is like no other that I've experienced before. And so to really help that process get around, we don't want them to have their phones on the table. We definitely don't want them to have their phones in the weight room. Now, that being said, a lot of these athletes are still trying to secure, say, contracts. And so social media plays a big role into that. So there's maybe a little bit of a fine line of what we need to allow them to do in terms of self-promotion and whatnot. But I agree that the cell phones and screen time, it's very difficult to manage. But we try to do our best when they're with us, at least.
Yeah, it's a tough one. And I mean, one of the little hacks we use here, especially with being so dark in the wintertime, is obviously trying to get the kids to even use their phones first thing in the morning. You know, that blue light can serve as a bit of a proxy for sunlight and help with some of the phase shifts versus when they do use it in the evening. Obviously really tough for that regenerative sleep, even if they don't have trouble falling asleep or staying asleep. So that's now if we shift gears a little bit, guys, I want to give some of the listeners, strength coaches, docs, therapists, enthusiasts here who are athletes in other sports, if you guys can maybe speak to, the benefits of sprinting. Is sprinting beneficial for all other athletes? Is that something that should be incorporated into programs for, hockey players, basketball players, et cetera?
Yeah, I think it absolutely is. Right now we're doing some consulting with a professional baseball team down here. And I think it's starting to take a shift where people are starting to realize the beneficial effects. But just from a standpoint of force production and angles of force production and awareness of your limbs in space, as well as carryover to maximal strength and peak power, I think there's a lot of benefits to sprinting and sprinting the right way for athletes of many, if not all, sports and a lot of different backgrounds.
And for athletes kind of just starting in and maybe, dipping their toe into adding this into their regimes, or strength coaches who want to start adding this in, is there, certain rep schemes or distances that you'd start with, drills that are crucial for kind of laying that foundation so the athletes are doing it the right way right from the get-go?
Just from like a drill standpoint, I think that it's noteworthy to mention that we don't really think drills are going to make you a faster sprinter per se, but what they can do is put things into context, and so you understand certain positions that we want to get you in. And so going through the series that we run, which is really variations of the an A walk, A march, a skip, I think that helps to put things into a little bit better context. I also think from a clinical side of things that we have a series called dribble series, which again allow us to control how much the vertical displacement and how much horizontal force we're able to put in. But because the movements are so controlled and a little bit attenuated, it becomes a great rehab tool, but it also becomes a good teaching tool as well. So that's where maybe I would start with, at least from a clinical standpoint. And then
I think it's noteworthy here, kind of where we start with our group, even though they are elite, we start from a very ground level and just build on there. So week one, week two, we're doing wall drills, which has the athlete just posted up on the wall, going through different sprint specific positions, finding different joint angles that we're trying to match with what we see once we start to open things up a little bit. And as Jed said, it's just to introduce some context and make sure that they're aware of the positions that we're looking for. And I think something like that is a great starting point for anybody. And then it's a matter of just monitoring volume and intensity. I don't think you have to run at maximal speed in order to reap the benefits. Especially if your mechanics aren't sound. And then I think it's important that you don't throw too much volume at these athletes from a sense of once they get under that fatigue, their mechanics will go out the window, and then you open up an increased risk for injury, just poor mechanics, poor force production, and all that. So monitoring all those things accordingly and starting from the ground up and taking a slow, progressive approach.
I will say that sprinting is a skill. And you need a fair amount of movement literacy to be able to express that skill. And so just like anything else, putting things into context and looking at maybe a dynamic system approach is a crucial point if you want someone to be able to express maximum velocity sprinting.
And, you know, in your opinion, with developing that skill in athletes of team sports and other sports, you know, you mentioned in terms of obviously the drills just being a way to integrate a lot of the things from a clinical side and a technique side and even down the road a performance side. You know, is that going to benefit the team sport athletes from you know, being able to implement some of those fundamental sort of drills into their regime?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that it's something that becomes readily available in their warm-up. And so you can easily take some of this stuff and incorporate it into a warm-up. And so you're not having to, say, spend time in developing strictly another biomotor ability away from everything else that they need to do. So I mean, with basketball, they got to work on shooting. They got to do, you know, plays and they have practice. When are they going to be able to fit this in addition to like their strength room stuff? So it's an easy way to manipulate a warm-up that will give you, you know, again, an ability to express positions and put things into context. Obviously, it will get, you know, your warm-up component of it. So you actually are going to have something that's beneficial prior to an event. And then it's a screen as well, and that's what we use it for. And so you're able to take away based on their positions, whether or not they're moving in something that's within their bandwidth or not, right? So there's, I think, multiple reasons as to why it's beneficial to incorporate it into a team sport.
Fantastic. That's a great tip, because especially with basketball players, I mean, in certain sports, you can get athletes who can go all the way up to the elite levels without even having to worry about the technique of how they run or how they sprint, obviously, which is the total reverse from being an elite sprinter. So it sounds like a great win-win to be able to start for coaches to get some of that into their warm-ups. Now, are there any things that, you know, coaches and strength coaches should consider before adding the sprinting in? Or, you know, Jason, you'd mentioned even, you know, obviously monitoring, you know, volume and whatnot, but are there other things that coaches should consider?
I think having an understanding of where someone's, I guess, body, for lack of a better word, is at. Are they going to be able to handle, from a tissue standpoint, going through a regime? And so it's almost the art of coaching, if you will, right? Like you have to have some inclination of knowing how their system is going to react to this, because again, it's you know, sprinting is no different than, in my mind, going through some of these, you know, power development exercises, which are quite taxing, especially if you know, just jump into it right away. So you obviously want to make sure that you've done something to qualify that the person has this physiological buffer zone to be able to go through a session that's going to be relatively intense.
Terrific, guys. I want to just shift gears here a little bit, because we're going to have, you know, again, some trainers and some just fitness enthusiasts who are getting more and more into sprinting. We see it all the time now on the blogs, magazines, articles, etc. And I know you guys work on the elite end of things. But if we talk about just the average client who's trying to lose that 20 pounds, maybe they have a beer belly, that kind of deal. And typically you see a lot of these people doing just longer bouts of steady state type work. You know, is sprinting and some of the high intensity interval training, do you guys think that's going to be a win for them? Are there things that they should consider before they jump right into that?
Yeah, I would. I think that if we put you through our warm-up, that would be more than enough of a work for most people, to be honest. And it's not just the general pop for that. Like, we've implemented this with like football teams, and you know, by the end of it, they're just exhausted. Or when we have our apprenticeship coaching programs or performance therapy programs, and we have visiting colleagues who go through their warm-up, they're done by it, right? So it's something that I think would be a good starting point, and it's, you're able to control a lot more with it, especially with joint velocity and joint ranges of motion. And so we can intelligently start to program how we're going to get someone up to, say, maximum velocity sprinting. But again, if the goal is just to, you know, say it's fat loss, I still think that the warm-up in itself is something that's going to help you increase that, you know, EPOC effect that you're looking for with some of this high intensity work that most people do.
Yeah, that EPOC, for those who, just a quick, you know, that's an exercise post-oxygen consumption. That's the afterburn you get from doing more intense work. And of course, when we look at the body composition of sprinters, whether they're female or male, obviously we see very lean, muscular body types. So, you know, adding more of this type of training in for the average person, you know, is that going to help them to put on some muscle and to find that six pack that's buried down there somewhere?
I guess depends would be my answer to that one. I mean, there's tons of different factors that we need to look into for that. And again, that will depend on the individual body type. But at the end of the day, I think that going through something like this, you'll develop general strength qualities and different perhaps tissue qualities that will set the stage for you to continue to, you know, progress through whatever weight room work that you want to do. So I think, again, it's a beneficial thing. Simple as a 15 or 30 minute warm up that can, you know, serve a lot of benefit in the long term.
I think if nothing else, it's a new stimulus for them. It's something that a lot of people probably, general population at least, probably don't do very often or very much of. So maybe they're using different muscle groups. Maybe they're challenging their nervous system in a different way. But to go out and sprint for them is a different challenge that their body has to adapt to. So if nothing else, I think it just provides that new stimulus and an additional opportunity to lean out, lose some weight, whatever their goal might be.
Yeah, it's amazing. I mean, with patients who come in here, I mean, I'm downtown Toronto, and we have, you know, some people come in and they've been obviously working at a desk for 10, 15, 20, 25 years. And sometimes you ask them when the last time they ran full out, and some people might tell you it was 15 or 20 years ago. So it's amazing how it's obviously from a health perspective influential on so many aspects of, you know, blood sugar control and hormone regulation and all these things. So that's fantastic. Now, if someone is sitting all day, if the average person's, you know, spending 8 or 10 or 12 hours in a chair and then they get up and just try to get on the track like an Andre DeGrasse, are there things that they should consider around, you know, mobility or certain muscle groups?
Yeah, I would say that you want to have a level of mobility and tissue extensibility for sure. Otherwise, you're probably looking at a hamstring injury, to be completely frank, if you're trying to go all out on day one. So like anything else, there's certain checks that you should be able to have, I think. A level of even just general strength, so that you have some stiffness and some compliance through tissue, can go a long way. Obviously, you want to have a requisite mobility level, so you can express full joint excursion, but still have the stability to control that range of motion. So, again, like anything else, when you're going to try to develop a new skill, it's beneficial to make sure you have all the requisites kind of in line and checked before you decide to, you know, try to go all out on something.
And for the average person there with kind of tight hips and maybe a weaker lower back, are there certain, you know, certain movements or things that you would emphasize?
I would say that you want to have at a very minimum the ability to disassociate hip from your femur. What we normally see, at least from a clinical standpoint, is people no longer have that ability to really hinge at their hips and start to use their low back. And I'm not saying that that's necessarily bad, but if that's the only way you can express movement, your movement variability is actually quite low. And it's maybe a potential for an injury mechanism to kind of occur. And of course, injury being multifactorial, maybe that's one of the things as to why that happens. So just having a good program that kind of addresses that and starts to move away from the stereotypical body part to more of a movement based one, and then continuing to work on that, and then you get a little bit more specific, right? And you can start to look at maybe, you know, power generation at single versus double, whether you're a pusher or you're a puller, you can start to look at those things. But just having a requisite capacity to do certain movements, I think, is a key thing.
One bit I'll add to this whole topic, the dribbles that Jas alluded to or mentioned in the start would possibly serve as a great place to start for anybody with the general population. And our dribble series or dribble progression is essentially just truncated range of motion running, slightly more specific to maximum velocity upright sprinting, I would say. But pretty much just starts over the ankle, then we progress up to over the calf and over the knee. So it's a cyclical motion, truncated range of motion. introduces a lot of opportunity for the athlete or individual to feel the ground contact and what that's going to be like. And if they slowly work up through bigger ranges of motion, again, over the calf and then progressing to the knee, might serve as a good progression into the tissue extensibility and different range of motions that Jas is talking about.
Terrific. That's great, guys. Have you any chance there's some videos there that we could post to the page that hosts this talk for people at home to have a look at?
Yeah, absolutely. We'll send some across. And then we also post a lot on the ALTIS social media sites. So you'll be able to find a lot there, but we'll send some specific to you guys.
Fabulous, guys. This is fantastic, man. Time flies here when we're talking to the experts. Can you guys, before we wrap up here, can you guys give us a bit of a glimpse for what the 2017 looks like for the ALTIS performance? You know, what does the schedule look like, or what are some of the things that you guys are gearing up for?
Oh, it looks good, man. We're in week 11 right now, and training has been pretty solid across the board. So I think there's a lot of excitement around ALTIS for the upcoming season. Obviously, it culminates at the end of the year with World Championships in London. Gosh, I think it's early August, might be late July. We'll have some people kicking off indoor meets starting next month in January. Most of the folks that Jas and I work with will hold off a little bit more until the outdoor season begins, possibly as late as April. But a couple meets here in the States, some Canadian meets, and then a handful of meets in Europe, just trying to tune up, get ready for nationals in the early summer and then worlds in late summer.
Fantastic. Well, guys, what's the best way, you know, for listeners who want to kind of keep tabs on what you guys are doing down there, what's the best way to connect with you guys on the interwebs there or Twitter, et cetera?
Yeah. So like Jason kind of alluded to, we try to have a strong social media presence. So you can follow us on Facebook, on Twitter, ALTIS World, and then on Instagram as well. In addition to that, we have our website. Feel free to visit that. And really just connect with us. If you see something cool on our Instagram or one of our Twitter posts, go ahead and leave a comment. We love to have dialogue. Selfishly, I think we learn sometimes more from the people who follow us than what we give out to them. So, but it's for us, it's all about communication and where we're going to learn from. So we absolutely love interaction with coaches and therapists and really anyone who's interested in what we're doing.
That's phenomenal. We'll definitely put those links, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, on the page as well. And I've saved the toughest question here for last, Jas. I know the coffee's pretty good here in Toronto. What's going on with the situation down there in Phoenix? Are you getting your hands on some good stuff, or what's going on?
Absolutely. For anyone who's coming to Phoenix, I think the spot you want to go to, I have a little bit of a picture, is a place called Mavericks. They serve ritual beans. And the cool thing about it is actually two of our athletes are the owners of this coffee spot. So it's become